Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. It's the middle of October. We're in the middle of launch season. I might as well be in the middle of a beer. Cheers. It really is this time of year that this show becomes crucially important as the tech news swells both in size and intensity in Q4, like a Cat 5 hurricane bearing down on Florida's west coast. Speaking of which, there is a Hurricane Milton disaster relief article linked in the description, by the way. We are pulling for all the folks in the greater Tampa area. And there are a bunch of other article links down there too because of all the tech news that happened this week. Intel had their expected Arrow Lake announcement Thursday that was unexpectedly blunt. The 9800X3D's launch date is still a free-floating mystery, and we now have, potentially, a trio of RTX 50 series GPUs coming from NVIDIA with the addition of the 5070 that look like they'll be announced at CES. So sit back and enjoy, because just like your Steam library, you have just been granted a temporary license for the tech news.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Corsair 3500X mid-tower computer case, featuring an elegant wraparound glass view with removable front and side panels, providing access to a spacious interior that supports up to EATX motherboards. It's also compatible with ASUS and MSI reverse connection motherboards for a clean build, includes convenient cable routing features, and accommodates up to 10 120mm fans with 360mm radiator support at the top and side. For more on the Corsair 3500X, click the sponsor link in the video description. Many Intel Arrow Lake rumors are now confirmed as of Thursday, with Intel's reveal of all the juicy specs and model names for their upcoming consumer PC platform. Five new Core Ultra Series CPUs will launch on October 24th. The flagship Ultra 9 285K with 24 cores and a 5.7 GHz peak frequency, two Ultra 7s, the 265K and 265KF with 20 cores and 5.5 GHz peak, and two Ultra 5s, the 245K and 245KF with 14 cores and 5.2 GHz max frequency. There's a mix of P cores and E cores again, with the Ultra 9 and 7 getting 8 P cores, and the Ultra 5s getting 6. Pricing is roughly the same as 14th gen Raptor Lake at launch, and despite big changes like the removal of hyperthreading and lower peak frequencies than last gen, Intel says their P cores are 9% faster in terms of IPC. And while we typically recommend waiting for independent reviews to verify manufacturer claims, Intel did seem to be more forthright than usual when it comes to performance expectations. Intel VP and General Manager of Client AI and Technical Marketing, Robert Halleck, aka Bobby Hacks, if I can get that nickname to stick, stated quite bluntly in a press briefing Q&A that we'll see about a 5% deficit in gaming performance for the Core Ultra 200 series versus AMD's 3D V-Cache-enabled 7800X3D. And while that's disappointing, it is also refreshing, I guess? The truth would come out eventually about the performance, so personally, I prefer this approach in letting us know what the performance expectations will be, rather than stringing us along with padded benchmarks up until the reviews come out. But hey, it sounds like Intel will have something in common with AMD, as neither of their next-gen late 2024 CPU lineups have been able to topple the 7800X3D when it comes to gaming prowess. Intel must instead rely on two things: the fact that there's lots of other stuff that people do with computers aside from gaming, and they do seem confident in Core Ultra 200's compute performance boosts over 14th gen, and their notable improvements to efficiency, which needs to be tested, but according to Intel, there can be anywhere from 30 to 160 watts reduced system power usage while gaming on the new platform, depending on the title. I guess the third thing Intel might be relying on is some consumer goodwill after their summer of inconsistency with 13th and 14th gen Raptor Lake CPUs, as discussed multiple times on this show. And while Intel's current problems are Intel's fault, hopefully no one wants Team Blue to fail completely. A bounce back would be preferable, which would require both a successful Core Ultra 200 series launch and a steady rebuilding of consumer trust. So the good news, fingers crossed, is that Intel now says they have fixed the instability issues that have plagued their 13th and 14th gen Raptor Lake CPUs. Turns out it was that pesky VMIN shift issue, and Intel spokesperson Thomas Hannaford now says, "We're confirming this is the cause and that it is fixed." So anyone running an Intel Raptor Lake CPU should update your motherboard's BIOS, again, to a version supporting the latest and supposedly final 0x12b microcode version. This should tame the four horsemen of the CPU instability apocalypse. It restores default power settings, corrects thermal velocity boost, and fixes two instances where elevated voltage could cause damage due to VMIN shift. Perfect timing, Intel. Now nothing can spoil your Ultra 200S desktop launch. Or perhaps we should not speak too soon, because we have renewed rumors that AMD's 9800X 3D CPU, which you'd expect to be better at gaming than the 7800X 3D that Intel already says is 5% faster than their new CPUs, but it could launch in early November, which would likely mean AMD drops a distracting announcement on or just before October 24th, when Intel's launch is scheduled. This comes from the Chip Health Forums over in China with a November 1st to 5th ETA, but it's still very much in the rumor category. So let's take a look at something more substantive. The best high-res CPU die shots on the internet, taken by Fritchens Fritz, whose name I'm almost assuredly mispronouncing. Fritz sacrificed a 9600X to get these incredibly detailed macro shots of the Zen 5 CCD and IO die, which were composited and colored to reveal the beauty and intricacy of the designs down to the micrometer level. The shots were further analyzed in this excellent video on the High Yield YouTube channel. All these are linked in my YouTube description, by the way. And apart from an excellent analysis of how Zen 5 is a ground-up redesign versus Zen 4, there was also a notable change to the TSV layouts. TSVs, or through-silicon vias, are used to mount and connect 3D V-cache memory to X3D CCDs, and due to their layout and the fact that there are fewer now, about 9,000 TSVs on Zen 5 versus 24,000 on Zen 3, there's speculation that AMD and TSMC might be double-stacking the V-cache this time around, which opens up a whole range of possibilities. If they can do two stacks, maybe they can do three, or four,
or hundreds.
If you want to know what all those different parts of the die do though, here's an annotated image from GPUs Are Magic. Really cool content from all three of these creators, so give them a follow if you want, and again, links are in the description. Speaking of magic GPUs, the mysterious disappearing RTX 50 series might finally be ready to commit to an announcement date. And really, what more can we ask for from Nvidia? And it looks like that date will be January 6th, 2025, sometime after 6:30 p.m. to be specific, which is when CEO Jensen Huang will be kicking off his CES keynote in Las Vegas. The keynote is confirmed. The RTX 50 series announcement is not, but further rumors this week are indicating a possible three-card launch, with the RTX 5070 added to the recently leaked RTX 5090 and 5080 cards. People are already mad at these rumors because it's the internet, but also because the 5070 is rumored to have only 12 gigabytes of 192-bit GDDR7 VRAM in 2025, which is an insult to all of our families and our ancestors, and also because there's clearly a huge gap between the 5090 and 5080, which has less than half the SMs and CUDA cores of its big brother. Add to it price rumors that harken back to the RTX 20 series launch, when Nvidia just stacked the new cards on top of the old ones at higher prices, and perhaps the insult and offense felt by our families and ancestors is wholly justified. Or maybe we shouldn't be too hard on Team Green, because we know that Nvidia makes GPUs for AI, but now they make AI for GPUs too. Specifically, a family of large multimodal language models called NVLM 1.0 that they went live with last week. Nvidia claims these advanced AI models are on par with leading proprietary solutions such as GPT-4, but perhaps more important is that they are free, with model weights currently available to the public, and a promise from Nvidia to release the training code too. It's also an adaptive model that improves accuracy over time. You know, a thinking machine, a learning computer like the Terminator T-800. What could go wrong? We should all be thanking Nvidia though. They're often chastised for their blatant focus on maximum profits, but here, they've magnanimously provided an advanced family of AI models to the whole world in an open format, dramatically increasing the number of regular people who have access to such tools. Provided, of course, that those regular people have a high-performance GPU that can handle such tasks, you know, like the ones Nvidia sells. I see what they did there. Ancestors and family offended once again. Speaking of offensive things, to keep this show from becoming offensively long, we pack the final few stories into a special segment called Tech Briefs. Gamers Nexus was also pretty hard on Team Green this week, with another meticulously constructed deconstruction of the upgrade no one asked for, the 12VH power connector, and its successor, the 12V2x6 connector. It's an hour plus deep dive on the failures and dead GPUs that have resulted from this poorly designed PSU accessory that pushes 600 watts of power through a too small 12+4-pin plug, with lab analysis, connector cross-sections, and ultimately a deep, frustrated sigh, since Nvidia is obstinately sticking to this connector for the 50 series as well. So while nothing is going to change anytime soon, there are some excellent recommendations for RTX 40 and 50 series GPU owners to make sure your power plug doesn't fail and melt into a bubbly, fuming mess. Speaking of a bubbly, fuming mess, there are at least a few commenters who have responded to news from Steam this week by imitating a failed 12VH power connector. That news being that we don't actually own the games we buy, we're only paying for a license, a revocable license. But in reality, this non-ownership status hasn't changed, it's just that Steam and other businesses are being forced to disclose it, thanks to me, or us, rather, Californians, who passed the law AB 2426, Consumer Protection, False Advertising, Digital Goods, which actually goes into effect next year, but some companies are getting an early start. So now, when you buy on Steam, a message says, a purchase of a digital product grants a license for the product on Steam, which is what you're buying, a license, not a physical copy of the game. Now we'll see if people respond by discussing the pros and cons of digital licensing and online marketplace services like Steam versus physical sales, or if they'd rather just say something hateful about California. But let's close with some green popcorn, as provided by Nvidia, who celebrated the 25-year anniversary of the GeForce 256 on Friday. It launched that long ago, in October 1999. Spec differences, as well as the sticker price, have changed drastically since then, if you compare the RTX 4090. Nvidia posted a video talking about all the stuff that's happened since 1999, from then to now. But of course, most of the comments are, you guessed it, complaining about the leaked RTX 50 series pricing. Good to know some things never change. But there you have it, guys, tech news for the week. And if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested. And you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, these awesome new mouse mats, and more. Channel memberships are now open. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.